Good evening, my dear brothers and sisters. I am Dr. Muruganathan, Governor of American College of Physicians. I am very pleased to welcome you to our masterclass webinar series on hypertension. Yesterday we had epidemiology and classification, and today the topic is pathophysiology, primary and secondary. In fact, pathophysiology of primary itself, you know, it is given in 22 pages. I don't know how Dr. Chenniappan, the speaker, is going to do the program within the limited time. But I request all of you to focus on this particular topic, very, very important. Because only if you understand the pathophysiology, you will understand the management. You will understand the complications. You will understand the whole hypertension. Especially in COVID-19 times, there are lot of articles, lot of problems are coming regarding hypertension, COVID. So unless you understand thoroughly about pathophysiology of hypertension, you may not understand the consequences and problems and various discussions. So I request all of you to focus and concentrate on this pathophysiology, and I request, I'm going to request Chenniappan to cover, if possible, secondary also, because within that given time, primary itself will cover, it will take long time. This is the 10 webinars, but just repeating the dates and time, you can see. Of course, now all of you know Dr. Chenniappan, but it's my duty to introduce him. He is a senior cardiologist from Trichy. He is an adjunct professor of the Tamil Nadu MGR Medical University, founder ECG and Echo Club of Trichy, multiple gold medalist, and has won numerous awards throughout his illustrious academic and medical careers. Recipient of Best Doctor Award, recipient of the gold medal from Association of Chest Physicians. He is instrumental in conducting various clinical trials like CREATE, OASIS, 5Y6, POISE and CLARIFY. And has various publications in national and international index journals. And he's also a master teacher. Our panelist, Dr. A.K. Panjolia, is HOD Medicine in Clinical Preventive Cardiology, Aryan Hospital, RC Indore. He was the organizing secretary, first CSI Heart Failure Conference Indore. He's a recipient of BC Roy Award and Charak Award by Madhya Pradesh IMA. Recipient of Excellence in Cardiology Award by National IMA, and speaker in ESC Congress London, speaker in WCC in 2014 Melbourne, 2016 Mexico, 2018 Dubai. He's an ex-associate editor of Indian Heart Journal, currently convener of RHD Council of CSI, regularly writing chapters in the textbook of cardiology and cardiology update. The other panelist, Dr. Rajshekhar, who is our own treasurer of the ACP India chapter, is a senior consultant physician and diabetologist, heart and diabetic therapy center in Kumbakonam, published many papers in medical journals and written chapters for textbook of medicine, APA, Hypertension Society of India. He's written a book on mnemonics in medicine, third edition, three editions he has written, published. He's a section editor of the yearbook of medicine 2018 and 19. And many other books, delivered many lectures in API, IMA, faculty in many national and international events, received Best Teacher Award by East Zone API Assam, Best Physician Award 2018 by Gulbarga College, Karnataka, Best Doctor Award by Tamil Nadu Government and Doctors Day Award from State IMA, Mary John Award from USA for Professional Excellence, Faculty for Cardiodiabetic Courses, PHFI, President Clinical Cardiodiabetic Society of India, past National Governing Body Member, API, Editor-in-Chief of International Journal of Cardiodiabetology. Also, he is a master teacher. Our friend from US, Atul Pawal, he is a medical director, University of Virginia Dialysis at Farmville, Chair of Medicine, Central Southside Community Hospital, Board Certified Internal Medicine and Nephrology, Certified Hypertension Specialist, AHSCP, Fellow of American College of Society of Nephrology, Fellow of National Kidney Foundation, selected as the Cassin Connolly Top Doctor in Virginia, Member of Alpha Omega Alpha, Member of Sigma 11 Scientific Research Honor Society, recipient of CMG Clinical Excellence Award 2019 for excellent patient care, recipient of 2020 Community Teaching Award by ACP Virginia Chapter, serves as an editorial board of American Journal of Nephrology and Medicine, and serves as an independent review committee of the United States of Blood Pressure Validated Devices Listing. My dear friends, today Dr. Wakar Ahmed from the Saudi, he had some problems so he could not join. The good news is, for all those people who are attending sincerely, regularly, we are going to give 7 credit hours. The Tamil Nadu Medical Council has given 7 credit hours. Now, yesterday we had a very nice quiz program. You know, everybody enjoyed the program. In fact, there are a lot of requests that you should play that again. But you know, fortunately, we downloaded the question and we have given it in all the WhatsApp group. All the 3 WhatsApp group, hypertension hits WhatsApp group. Yesterday quiz program, question answer is there. Okay, and yesterday there were 103 delegates participated in the quiz program, and 50% of them have answered more than 5 questions. Only 3, 2 only answered 7 questions. So today, let us play very nicely the same Kahoot.it in your laptop or mobile. After Dr. Chenyappan's talk, please type Kahoot.it in your laptop or a mobile and be ready, and we will give you a game pin number. And once you have the game pin number, you enter the pin and your name. Then you can play. There are 10 questions. Yesterday, we gave for each question only 20 seconds. So some people called me and said, sir, 20 seconds is not enough. So today, for every question, you have 30 seconds to answer, which means for 10 questions, you will have 5 minutes. So in 5 minutes, you will answer 10 questions. One important thing, though you give correct answer, if you don't answer correctly early, if suppose 2 people answer same question, the number A gets more marks if he answers before B. So as soon as you know the answer, please click and then get more marks. Okay, this is just a fun play, and I'm happy so many people have called me and said it is very interesting. So today also we'll play that after Chenyappan's talk. So thank you for your attention. Now I have great pleasure in welcoming Dr. Chenyappan to give his talk on pathophysiology of hypertension, primary and secondary. Over to you, Chenyappan.
Good evening, all of you, sir. Dr. Murunathan, sir, the co-faculty and dear delegates. And it is my pleasure again to join you in this evening to talk to you about the regulation of blood pressure and a huge topic on pathophysiology of hypertension. As Dr. Murunathan correctly put it, it's a huge topic. Let's see how we are going to do it. So the motives of this lecture is going to be to learn first about the regulation of normal blood pressure. Then we understand the mechanisms of underlying hypertension, and we see understanding this underlying mechanisms will give us a clue how to treat a hypertension patient. So ultimately it boils down to that. So first of all, we must know what is blood pressure. Blood pressure is, arterial blood pressure is defined as a measure of lateral force exerted by the blood column per unit area of vessel wall. So that is the definition of blood pressure. It is the pressure exerted by the blood column on the lateral side. Systolic blood pressure is the maximum pressure during systole, that is ventricular systole. It is a function of cardiac output as well as aortic resistance. So diastolic blood pressure is minimum pressure exerted during diastole. It is the load against which the heart has to work. So it is a measure of peripheral resistance. The pulse pressure is defined as the difference between systolic and diastolic blood pressure, and also determines the pulse volume. Mean arterial blood pressure is diastolic blood pressure plus 1/3 of pulse pressure. There is another complicated calculation is there. This is a simple calculation where we can do it day in, day out. And mean pressure means it is average pressure head throughout the cardiac cycle. So with these definitions, we first come to how normally our blood pressure is regulated. There are short-term mechanisms, intermediate-term mechanisms, and long-term mechanisms. The short-term mechanisms are baroreceptor reflexes. The intermediate mechanisms are capillary fluid shifts into the interstitium as well as stress relaxation of the vessels. And long-term mechanisms is going to be pressure diuresis, naturesis, and renin angiotensin aldosterone system. So in the short term, the blood pressure is maintained by this baroreceptor mechanism. As you can see, our system has got a lot of sensors in the body, just like our modern car, which is sensing always the intravascular volume and the intravascular pressure. So because the intravascular pressure and volume is constantly given as an input to our brain, and the brain decides what it has to do for this particular pressure and volume. For example, let us say I have a low intravascular volume and pressure. It conveys, the brain takes it that there is a low intravascular volume and pressure. So it stimulates cardiostimulatory center, which is going to increase our sympathetic activity, increase the heart rate and contractility. It is going to produce vasoconstriction. It is going to release aldosterone, which is going to retain sodium and water. And it is also going to act on the kidney to conserve fluid and solutes. So in this way, it can restore the intravascular volume and pressure. Let us say I have a very high blood pressure and very high volume inside my vessels. Then the cardio inhibitory center is activated. Through the vagal afferents, it is going to produce decrease in heart rate, decrease in contraction and vasodilatation. So that it, in this way, it can reduce the blood pressure. So these are the short-term adaptation for day in, day out increase and decrease in blood pressure. The intermediate term regulation of blood pressure is done by the capillary shifts, the fluid shifting from the capillary into the interstitium, as well as the stress relaxation of the vessels, which actually, so relaxation or contraction, shifting inside or outside, regulates intermediate regulation of blood pressure. And the long-term regulation is done by a mechanism called pressure naturesis, where the increase in blood pressure will distend the cardiac muscle. Whenever the cardiac muscle is distended, natriuretic peptides are released, which are going to produce the renal vasodilatation and increase the GFR, and they are also going to excrete sodium and water. In this way, they are going to reduce the distension produced by excessive blood pressure by the sympathetic stimulation and other vasoconstrictors. In addition to that, whenever the vasodilatation is happening, as you know, because of the decrease in intravascular volume and sodium, because the sodium gets excreted, the renin is secreted less, thereby you have less angiotensin and less aldosterone. Once again, they contribute to decrease in blood pressure. So this is called pressure naturesis done by natriuretic peptides. Whereas our renin angiotensin system is going to act whenever there is a decrease in blood pressure as well as decrease in volume inside. So the angiotensinogen is going to be converted to angiotensin. You can see that converted by the renin, and the angiotensin 1 is going to be converted to angiotensin 2 by converting enzyme inhibitors. Once the angiotensin 2 acts on the AT1 receptor in the vessels, it is going to produce vasoconstriction. And in the adrenals, it is going to increase the aldosterone secretion. And of course, aldosterone is going to retain sodium and water, and constriction of blood vessels is going to restore your blood pressure. So that means in this system also, you can restore the intravascular volume and pressure. So whenever there is a high pressure, we have the pressure naturesis. Whenever we have low pressure, we have an angiotensin system to restore the pressure and volume. The long-term regulation is also done by the baroreceptor stimulus is also not only acting on cardioinhibitory and stimulatory center, it can also on the hypothalamic region or posterior pituitary to secrete the ADH or vasopressin. So the vasopressin is going to constrict your vessels, and antidiuretic hormone is going to retain water from the collecting tubules. Thereby, they restore the blood pressure as well as the intravascular volume. So these are the mechanisms in place to actually regulate your blood pressure day in and day out. So the problem in hypertension is that many of these mechanisms, which are supposed to work when the blood pressure is abnormal, they exaggerate in their work and they become overshoot. These mechanisms get overshoot, and then the high blood pressure happens. So I'm not very sure when I started this talk where to start and where to end my pathophysiology of hypertension. So I took this picture from Braunwald's Textbook of Cardiology. So it gives you a very nice idea about the basic clinical situations, pathological pathways, the real pathology, and of course the clinical event. So we can go by this to understand the pathophysiology of the heart, as well as the high blood pressure. So blood pressure is nothing but the cardiac output and peripheral resistance. The cardiac output is going to be influenced by the preload, which is a venous return, and the contractility of the heart. The peripheral resistance is going to be influenced by the vascular spasm and anatomical narrowing of the artery by the structural hypertrophy. So many mechanisms are going to act in these four important pathologies like preload, contractility, spasm, and vascular narrowing. And these are the clinical conditions. And of course, these are the pathological pathways. And this is a real pathology which ultimately produces increase in blood pressure by either increase in cardiac output or increase in peripheral resistance or both. So you have hypertension because of these mechanisms. First, we take up from here excessive salt intake. So we started with a very, very important aspect of our life, which is a salt intake. So there is a condition called salt sensitive hypertension. It's a very old theory, which is easy to understand. Whenever you take extra salt, you have to have extra salt excretion by the kidney, and you must have decreased sympathetic activity. Thereby, your extra salt is not going to produce increase in blood pressure. But in patients who are salt sensitive, what happens is this increase in salt is not going to decrease your sympathetic activity, or actually through the sympathetic activity, by opening the co-transporter channels, sodium chloride co-transporter channels, this is going to increase the sodium reabsorption. So the kidney is not able to adjust its sodium reabsorption according to the salt we take, either through the sympathetic system or through the kidney itself. As we can see from RAC to mineralocorticoid receptors, it is going to act on epithelial sodium channels. So either through the epithelial sodium channels or through the transporters, co-transporters, in spite of a patient is taking excessive salt, the kidney is not able to excrete more salt. In opposite, they increase the sodium reabsorption and ultimately the patient develops blood pressure. So estimated incidence is 51% of patients with hypertension. Salt sensitive hypertension is around 51% in our patients with hypertension. The second, we come to the kidney, reduced nephron number. So I should not be talking in the presence of Dr. Atul, but anyway, you can add whatever I have left in this lecture about the kidney and hypertension. So basically the reduced nephron number is going to do two things, which is going to, so actually the excessive sodium salt because of the increase. So you must understand whenever the sodium is reabsorbed, water is automatically reabsorbed. Sodium always goes with the water. So excessive salt intake is going to contribute to increase in fluid volume and thereby going to increase your venous return. The reduced nephron number is going to do two things. It is going to produce renal sodium retention as well as there going to be decreased filtration surface. There is a decrease in GFR as well as sodium retention. Once again, this is going to increase our fluid volume and contribute to increase in preload. The hypertension, so many hypertension and kidney have got very close relationship. So you must understand kidney may be the culprit even in the absence of kidney disease. We always think whenever hypertension and kidney disease is there, it is secondary to kidney disease. But kidney disease can actually will be the main culprit of the hypertension itself. So that's why we say kidney is the cause and effect of hypertension. So this is how the kidney acts, a very simple chart. So the primary thing, whenever you have a high sympathetic system, stimulated renin angiotensin system, low potassium diet, and some drug use, there is a vasoconstriction, which is going to result in ischemia and inflammation, as well as arteriopathy, preglomerular arteriopathy. So because of that ischemia, there is an increased vasoconstrictor response and decreased vasodilator response. And because of that, there is significant sodium reabsorption. because I have arteriopathy, my blood flow, the resistance is increased. I have a decreased renal blood flow. I have decreased sodium filtration. So I am not able to excrete sodium, and whatever sodium I excrete is going to be reabsorbed in the tubules. So that's what the kidney is contributing to, the sodium retention and increase in blood pressure. So subtle renal injury can go into decreased sodium excretion as well as the reabsorption, and of course increase in blood pressure. So there are many evidences to say that the kidney can cause hypertension even without nephropathy. So high albumin excretion actually can precede the onset of overt hypertension. We always look for albumin excretion after the onset of hypertension, but it has been shown albumin excretion may precede the overt hypertension. And even before that, the cystatin C, which is one of the important kidney injury markers, can precede the onset of hypertension. That means your renal disease is going to come before the hypertension and can cause hypertension. And the animal experiments with the blood pressure goes with the kidney, which means the kidney, which is genetically programmed to develop hypertension, if it is going to be transplanted into a normotensive patient, and that patient will develop persistent hypertension, which is proving that the kidney can produce hypertension. So the main mechanisms of contributing hypertension from the genetic aspects is upregulation of sodium channels, upregulation of renin-angiotensin system, cortisol to mineralocorticoid receptors, and sympathetic overactivity. So we have seen the kidney as the cause of hypertension. Now we are going to see the kidney as the effect of hypertension, what the hypertension is going to do for the kidney. It is shown in many, many studies that you higher the blood pressure, higher is your decline in GFR. So higher your mean blood pressure, there is a higher decline in your renal function. So the hypertension worsens kidney disease worsens hypertension. So this is the cause and effect of hypertension, kidney disease predisposed to hypertension, and hypertension predisposed to kidney disease. Early detection of kidney disease and treating it will prevent major kidney damage. And similarly, the control of hypertension will retard the progression of future kidney disease. The kidney is as important as heart and brain in hypertension management. And of course, in hypertension, we must prevent ESRD. Then we come to the next thing, which is the stress, the mental stress or physical stress, which is going to increase our sympathetic activity. What the sympathetic activity is going to do, it is going to increase the heart rate and contractility, going to increase the cardiac output, and thereby going to increase your blood pressure. So sympathetic activity increases the heart rate and contractility to have increase in output. It is going to increase the vascular tone at the pre-capillary level, the smaller arteries. So it increases the peripheral resistance. So cardiac output is increased, peripheral resistance is increased. The two components of blood pressure is increased, you have high blood pressure. And once again, just like your salt sensitive or kidney disease, the sympathetic activity itself is going to increase sodium and water reabsorption from the tubules. In addition to that, so it is going to increase the preload also, in addition to increase in cardiac output. And ultimately, it produces adverse vascular remodeling. Thereby, the vascular lumen anatomically gets narrowed, which maintains the high blood pressure and also exacerbates hypertension. So this is the sympathetic activity role in the hypertension pathophysiology. So having seen the sympathetic activity, next we come to the renin-angiotensin excess. The renin-angiotensin excess is a very important mechanism by which we are going to have hypertension. So now we look at the basic pathophysiology of RAS-induced hypertension. So we have already seen that the angiotensin 2 is converted from angiotensin 1 from angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitor. So once there is an angiotensin 2 acting on AT1 receptor, is going to increase your sympathetic activity, and it is going to increase your sodium chloride reabsorption and also the potassium excretion. I told you, sodium reabsorption will always go with the water retention. So sodium and water is retained. Acting on the adrenal gland, it is going to increase aldosterone secretion, which is once again going to retain sodium and water in addition to angiotensin itself. and then it is going to produce significant vascular contraction, thereby increasing the peripheral resistance and afterload, and also acting on the brain and secreting more the vasopressins and antidiuretic hormones. It is also going to reabsorb more water. So in this way, the combination of increase in heart rate and contractility, retaining of sodium water through the angiotensin and loss of the system by constricting the vessels and also reabsorbing the water, the angiotensin system is going to produce significant impact in the production of hypertension. So in addition to that, on the kidney itself, the angiotensin can do a lot of things to increase the blood pressure. It produces significant efferent arterial constriction. So when it produces significant efferent arterial constriction, there is a significant increase in intraglomerular pressure. So intraglomerular pressure is going to increase the excretion of the sodium, and reabsorption is also increased. Proteinuria is going to damage the nephron, and you are going to have less filtration surface. The second mechanism is less filtration surface. It is also done by angiotensin by damaging the nephrons and excreting the protein. So this results in glomerular ischemia, parenchymal damage, proteinuria, and ultimately goes in for end-stage renal failure. So it can also cause kidney disease, which can exacerbate the hypertension. So there is a lot of interest today on ACE2. We have already seen the stimulus for renin is the hyponatremia, increased afferent arterial perfusion pressure, increase in sympathetic activity, and increase in vasodilatation. So these are the stimulus for the renin to get secreted. Ultimately, the angiotensin 2 is going to be formed, which is acting on the AT1 receptor, is going to produce the smooth muscle contraction and smooth muscle hypertrophy, increase in vascular resistance, aldosterone release. We have seen all this in the previous slide. But thing is, if you are able to block the angiotensin 2 action on the AT1 receptor, the postulation is that it can act on AT2 receptor, which will have exactly the opposite effects of the angiotensin 2 on AT1 receptor. But another important molecule is here, the angiotensin converting enzyme 2, ACE2, is going to convert this bad angiotensin 2 into good molecules like angiotensin 1 to 7. Once again, this angiotensin 1 to 7 is going to act on the exactly the opposite way of angiotensin 2 on AT1 receptor. Anti-proliferative effects, naturesis, vasodilatation, ultimately it is going to decrease the blood pressure. It seems as if the angiotensin 2 is not a bad fellow, but the combination of the angiotensin 2 to angiotensin 1 is going to be actually producing the bad effects. If the angiotensin 2 is going to act on AT2 receptor or is going to be converted to angiotensin 1 to 7, I think it is going to do some good thing against hypertension. So that's why the role of ACE2 is very important these days, because everybody is talking about this. So the angiotensin 2 on the vessels, it can produce early lesion and it can produce progressive plaque increase, and the plaque volume it can increase, and also it can produce the plaque rupture and also the thrombus, an acute event. A significant narrowing in the lumen actually can produce significant hypertension, and it can also produce end organ damage by the rupture of the plaque and thrombus in the form of myocardial infarction or cerebral infarction. So what the ACE2 does is directly it can block the action of angiotensin 2 on the vessels, or it can convert the angiotensin 2 into angiotensin 1 to 7, which is going to reverse this progressive vascular pathologies and can prevent stroke and myocardial infarctions. And of course, the other mechanism is acting through the MAS, which is mitochondrial assembly protein, and combination of this angiotensin 1 to 7 with the mitochondrial assembly protein is actually going to do very good for the vessels by decreasing the proliferation and migration of vascular smooth muscle cells and release of the pro-inflammatory cytokines and macrophages. It is going to reverse whatever the adverse remodeling is, which is going to be done by the angiotensin 2 itself. So that is the importance of ACE2 today. And of course, when you come to the COVID, why the COVID, and there is a lot of controversy about whether to use an angiotensin inhibitor or ARB in the presence of a COVID is this. So what this COVID virus does is takes the angiotensin 2 receptor to go into the cell. And once the virus goes into the cell, inside the cell it gets entry, inside the cell it gets replicated, and of course it produces what is known as ACE2 down regulation. That means you have less available ACE2. So when you have less available ACE2, it is not going to convert your angiotensin 2 into good molecules. That means your bad molecule is going to increase and it is going to act on this AT1 receptor to produce the whatever the mechanisms of acute lung injury, myocardial remodeling, vasoconstriction, vascular permeability. So that's why you have to continue ACE inhibitor and ARB, which are trying to reduce either the formation of angiotensin 2 or its action at AT1 receptor through COVID, because if you stop these molecules, the angiotensin 2 is not going to be converted to a good molecule, and the amount of angiotensin 2 acting on the AT1 receptor is going to increase, and it is going to exacerbate whatever the pathology it is doing for the lungs and the heart. So then the next molecule is aldosterone. Aldosterone is not a molecule which is just going to increase our sodium and water reabsorption. So many times we think the aldosterone antagonists like spironolactone and eprilinone are simple diuretics. No, they are going to block this very bad molecule, which not only retains sodium and water, it excretes potassium and magnesium, a very, very important problem in producing arrhythmias, hypokalemia and hypomagnesemia. They are going to act on the endothelial function and produce endothelial dysfunction, and acting on the big arteries to reduce the arterial compliance. And they are also prothrombotic effects. And because of all this, it can produce increase in blood pressure, which is going to produce increase in left ventricular hypertrophy, and ultimately the increase in hypertrophy, which results in ultimately the heart failure. And aldosterone is the main factor in producing myocardial and vascular fibrosis. So in this way, it is going to decrease your parasympathetic activity and increase in sympathetic activity. Thereby, it can produce cardiac arrhythmias, hypertension, and also end-stage renal disease. So aldosterone is also a very important factor in producing hypertension through the RAS system. Why I have spent so much time in RAS system is because it's the only pathological pathway which can, through the venous constriction, can increase the preload. Through the sympathetic activity, can increase the contractility. It can produce a vascular spasm, and producing smooth muscle hypertrophy, it can increase the structural hypertrophy. So the only system which is going to act on all the four pathology is going to be renin-angiotensin system. That's why the RAS inhibitors have become so important in the treatment of hypertension, because it is the only mechanism where all these things are going to be happening. Then we come to the genetics, the cell membrane alteration by the genetic genes and hypertension. So the high blood pressure before 55 occurs 3 times more frequently among persons with a positive family history of hypertension. That's why in the history, the family history of hypertension is important, because that prevalence or the incidence is going to be around 4-fold. The genes encode the components of renin-angiotensin aldosterone system are going to play a role, along with the converting enzyme polymorphism, as well as the blood pressure sensitivity to dietary sodium. There is one gene called alpha-adducin gene, which is thought to be associated with the increased tubular reabsorption of sodium. So in addition to all the system, a gene can influence your tubular reabsorption of sodium. And the family studies and variations in the candidate genes are associated with the renal damage. So the genes also decide whether the patient is going to get hypertensive nephropathy or not. So here we have told you, we have shown you some of the genetic mechanism. Gene and hypertension itself is going to be a very big topic. I think Dr. Murugnathan will take it up in the advanced hypertension course. And you can start from the renin. So the gene can influence your fibromuscular area and produce renal artery stenosis. And on the angiotensin, angiotensin variant can happen because of the genetic abnormalities. And primarily on the mineralocorticoids in the aldosterone, there can be aldosterone synthetase gene or hydroxylase deficiency which can influence the mineralocorticoids, and receptor activity can be influenced by the gene, and of course you can have variety of Mendelian monogene abnormalities like Gittleman syndrome, Liddle syndrome, and pseudohypoaldosteronism, which is going to affect the two important areas where the sodium gets reabsorbed. Some of the genes is going to affect the sodium chloride cotransporter, and some of the genes are going to affect the epithelium sodium channel, which is in the distal convoluted tube, which is in the collecting channel and acting like aldosterone. So these are the genetic abnormalities in various areas of our system, especially the renin-angiotensin system, renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, which is going to produce hypertension in a hereditary way. Of course, the other genes we have told you, which is independently acting apart from this RAS system, is going to be alpha-adrenergic gene, as well as the genes which are going to produce hypertensive nephropathy. So this is as far as the genetic alteration concerned, which is going to produce significant cell membrane alteration and also can produce significant sodium and water retention. And this is actually can produce the and also produce significant damage to your the vessels in the form of the functional constriction as well as structural hypertrophy. They can also produce the increase in preload by retaining sodium and water acting through the renin-angiotensin system. So the genetic alterations can happening in variety of these pathologies. And we come to next, our modern risk factor, the obesity and insulin resistance is a very important cause today. The one of the important causes of increase in hypertension prevalence in our country is increase in weight. The obesity and increase in the fat cells itself, you know, the adipocyte is no longer considered as a godown of fat, but it's a factory which can produce so many bad substances and can produce significantly elevate the blood pressure. So the obesity or increase in cell mass is going to produce a leptin, and through the brain it can increase the sympathetic activation, and the adipose RAS, adipose system itself can produce renin angiotensin system and produce angiotensin 2 and can increase the vascular tone to produce vasoconstriction, and they can also act on the adrenals, and the free fatty acids released from the adipocytes can actually can produce more aldosterone and act on the kidney. And of course, the adipocytes themselves are going to increase the mineralocorticoid releasing factors acting on the adrenals to release more aldosterone, thereby sodium and water retention. The insulin resistance have got lot of pathways by which the hypertension can be produced. So the insulin resistance can happen because of the lifestyle factors, genetic factors, the malnutrition, early life, drugs and hormones. Once early resistance happens, two things are happen in the metabolic tissues because of increase in insulin level. Ultimately, this results in increase in intracellular sodium, which ultimately results in increase in intracellular calcium, because the sodium will take the calcium's pathway to go out of the cell. So the increase in intracellular calcium is going to produce significant contraction of vascular smooth muscle. Because of the insulin resistance, there's a significant endothelial dysfunction. So the nitric oxide produced by the endothelium comes down. So this adds on to the vascular contraction or contractile vascular muscle cells. The insulin resistance is also going to produce increase in angiotensin. We have already shown all the ill effects of angiotensin, including vascular contraction, vascular smooth muscle hypertrophy, retaining of sodium and water, increase in sympathetic activity. And of course, it is also going to produce aldosterone, which is going to produce sodium and water retention. And of course, the increase in insulin itself is going to increase your sympathetic activity. The unopposed sympathetic stimulation, which will happen, is also going to contribute to the contractility as well as the hypertrophy. Here, all these mechanisms, especially angiotensin and sympathetic system, is not only going to produce the contraction of the vessels, but they are going to produce smooth muscle hypertrophy, proliferation of smooth muscle, and they are anatomically going to reduce the vascular lumen. So this will result in significant increase in peripheral vascular resistance. Ultimately, the patient may end with hypertension. So these are the mechanisms by which your insulin resistance can produce hypertension in the form of increase in intracellular calcium, decrease in nitric oxide through the angiotensin, through the aldosterone, and through the sympathetic system. So having seen how this obesity and hyperinsulinemia is going to produce a significant hypertension, primarily in this aspect, they are primarily going to reduce your vascular resistance, the increase of vascular resistance, and that can contribute to significant increase in vascular resistance. And of course, obesity itself is going to produce a significant increase in preload and can contribute to hypertension. Then we come to the last factor, which is the vessel, endothelium-derived factors, which are going to act on the vascular constriction as well as vascular hypertrophy, and thereby increase the peripheral resistance and increase the blood pressure. So we must understand the normal arterial function. We have two types of arteries in our system. One is a big arteries like aorta and pulmonary artery, which are called the cushion arteries. These arteries called cushion arteries because they have a significant elastin in their media. Because of the immediate dilatation as soon as the heart contracts, these big vessels, especially the aorta, is going to significantly reduce the pulse wave velocity to the periphery. It is going to slow down the systolic velocity to the periphery so that it tries to maintain the continuous flow of the distributing arteries or the arterioles. So this is called cushion function because the dilatation of the big vessels is going to reduce the pulse wave velocity and thereby do not expose the very high pressure generated by the heart to happen and go to the peripheral vessels. Whereas the conduit arteries are the ones which have got predominantly smooth muscle in their media. These are the arteries which supply the vital organs, coronary arteries, cerebral arteries, renal arteries. Why they have the smooth muscles? The smooth muscle can contract and relax and regulate the blood flow to the vital organs. That's why these are conduit arteries. And these conduit arteries are primarily acting through the endothelium, and endothelial dysfunction is going to affect this conduit function. And of course, the endothelial function and the intima disease is going to produce atheroma, plaque, thrombus, and can produce significant blockade of the blood to the vital organs such as heart and the brain and the kidney, can produce acute coronary syndrome or acute cerebral event. So these are the two functions of our normal cushion function and conduit function. How this is going to contribute to the development of hypertension? So this is your intima and this is your media, and our big vessels, our cushion vessels, they have a predominant elastin in their media. So beautifully they dilate and relax and reduces the pulse wave velocity to the periphery. So the action of the big arteries like aorta is cushioning effect. Whereas the conduit arteries are predominantly have smooth muscle in their media. And if at all they are going to be occluded, they are going to be occluded by the intimal disease, which produces endothelial dysfunction, atheroma, plaque, and ultimately narrow the lumen. So the big arteries, cushion arteries, are going to contribute to hypertension because of loss of elastin in their media. So the aorta becomes very stiff. When the aorta becomes very stiff, it is going to transmit the pulse velocity, is going to be increased. It is going to transmit the pulse wave very rapidly to the peripheral vessels and thereby increase the pressure at the peripheral or the conduit arteries. So this is called arteriosclerosis. It is the disease of media where the patient is going to lose elastin in the media and the aorta is going to become stiff and it is going to contribute to systolic hypertension because the rapid transmission of the systolic wave to the periphery. Whereas as far as the conduit arteries are concerned, how they are going to contribute to hypertension is going to actually narrow the lumen by producing atheroma and plaque. So this is an intimal disease. So the disease, the intimal disease, is atherosclerosis. So here the hypertension is going to happen because of the decrease in lumen size because of the plaque, thrombus, and atheroma. It's an intimal disease, which is atherosclerosis. And of course, in big arteries, you have the loss of elastin in the media, so it's a medial disease. So arteriosclerosis is a medial disease, atherosclerosis is intimal disease. So the abnormal cushion function by the aorta, abnormal conduit function by your conduit arteries can ultimately produce what is known as vascular aging and then significantly contribute to hypertension. And of course, you must know which hypertension is produced by which artery. So this is your cushion artery. The cushion artery has got predominantly elastin in the media, so it has to be beautifully dilating as soon as the heart contraction, so that it gives a slow pulse velocity to your conduit arteries. So whenever the elastin gets damaged due to elderly population, due to the elderly age, the elastin gets degenerated in the media of aorta. Aorta becomes stiff and the cushion function is lost. And this is called arteriosclerosis, which is a disease of media. Because the cushion function is lost, what BP are going to get here is going to be isolated systolic hypertension or systolic hypertension with a low diastolic pressure. Whereas whenever my peripheral arteries are going to be narrowed because of the intimal disease, atheroma and plaque, what I'm going to have is going to be significant increase my peripheral resistance because my peripheral arteries are blocked, and what blood pressure I am going to have is going to be increase in my diastolic blood pressure, which may contribute to the diastolic hypertension. So in this way, the combination of these produce ultimately systolic and diastolic hypertension. This is to understand the very important mechanism of the most dangerous pressure I told yesterday, high systolic pressure and a low diastolic pressure. Whenever my aorta is compliant, it is dilating nicely and my pulse velocity is slowly going to the periphery and my reflected wave is going to come in diastole. That's why the reflected wave from the periphery is going to contribute to my good diastolic pressure. And because my pulse velocity is going slowly, and because it is going to slowly, and I'm not going to have a correct systolic pressure, and because the returning wave is coming in the diastole, I have a good diastolic pressure, and this is called ventricular vascular coupling, which means when the ventricle contracts, the aorta should get dilated, and it is going to go to reduce your pulse velocity less than 8 meters per second. And because I have a good diastolic pressure, my coronary blood flow is good. Whereas let us imagine what will happen when aorta becomes stiff and it is not dilating and it is going to rapidly transmit my pulse wave to the periphery, and the reflected pulse wave also comes very quickly. And what's happening, you are going to see, is rapid transmission of onward pressure as well as the returning pulse or the reflected wave also comes in systole. This no longer comes in diastole when the aorta becomes stiff. It is also going to come in systole itself. Thereby, you can see it here. This is a normal thing. This is your systolic pressure. This is a reflected wave which is coming in diastole. So this is a normal arterial pulse wave. So I get a normal systolic pressure, good diastolic pressure. Let us imagine this reflected wave is also going to add to my systolic pressure. There is an enormous increase in my systolic pressure. Because the reflected wave has already come in systole, what you have will be a lower diastolic pressure. So this is what happens in a high systolic pressure and a low diastolic pressure. You can see that here, that the rapid transmission of the pulse wave in systole, the pulse velocity goes more than 12 meters per second, and the reflected wave comes in systole itself, contributing to high systolic pressure. The high systolic pressure is going to increase enormous cardiac muscle demand, because my left ventricle is going to have a very enormous resistance in my artery to contract. So my demand significantly increases. What happens to my supply? Because of my low diastolic pressure, I have significant decrease in my coronary flow. So which contributes to the subsequent catastrophic event like coronary artery disease. And that's why we said this pressure is very dangerous and it reflects stiff aorta, which contributes a high systolic pressure and a low diastolic pressure. So the next we come to the intimal disease of atherosclerosis, which starts with endothelial dysfunction, and the lipid accumulation in the intima causes atheroma, smooth muscle accumulation causes that converts into a plaque, and the plaque becomes significantly big to narrow the artery, or it can rupture to produce a thrombus, which can produce acute vascular event. So in this way, the conduit arteries are going to contribute to your hypertension primarily in the form of increase in peripheral resistance and also going to increase your diastolic pressure. So in this way, the arteries, the wave reflections, if it is a cushion artery abnormality, you are going to have increase in pulse pressure, which can produce a macrovascular damage. Whereas when you have a conduit problem due to intimal disease, your diastolic pressure and mean artery pressure is going to go up, and it can produce microvascular damage. So this is how we understand how our arteries or the blood vessels are contributing to the development of hypertension in our day-to-day practice. So that's why the systolic pressure is primarily the function of the cushion artery. The diastolic pressure is going to be the function of the conduit arteries. So having decided that, now we come to the yesterday, one of the delegates have asked about the age and blood pressure. So in young, the primarily the pressure is going to be primarily due to increase in cardiac output because of, you know, the genetic abnormalities like preload increase mainly contributing, sympathetic activity mainly contributing. So in the middle age, it is a combination of increase in cardiac output and increase in peripheral resistance. And in this peripheral resistance, primarily the conduit vessels are involved. Whereas in elderly, there is actually the cardiac output is decreased and there is a significant peripheral resistance primarily offered by the increase in stiffness of your big arteries. That's why you have an isolated systolic pressure here and low diastolic pressure sometimes also happens. So with this, we have finished the pathophysiology of the primary hypertension, going through that Braunwald diagram, going through the clinical conditions, the pathological pathways, and how they influence or contribute to the real pathology, like cardiac output or a peripheral resistance to increase the blood pressure. So now we come to the secondary hypertension. I will briefly go through the basic mechanisms only. I'm not going to go detail about each condition, just the basic mechanisms of a secondary hypertension. So when to look for secondary hypertension? Look for secondary hypertension in all your hypertensives. And of course, test for secondary hypertension only we have some evidence in your clinical examination or in your investigations. You have a doubt, test that patient for a secondary hypertension depending upon your comprehensive evaluation, which includes, don't forget, a clinical examination, a good clinical examination and appropriate investigations. So we have already told you how to remember the common causes of the secondary hypertension. So it's called CROPT, the chronic kidney disease, and we have told you renal vascular disease. We see one by one them, and we can also see some rarer causes, how they contribute to hypertension. So when to suspect secondary hypertension? I just listed some 12 points clinically to suspect secondary hypertension. Any difficult to control hypertension, you are using 3 or 4 drugs, the pressure is not coming down. That means you may be missing a secondary cause. Onset of hypertension before the age of 30 years. Onset of diastolic blood pressure, hypertension after the age of 65 years. We have already seen through the vessel abnormality, vessel pathology, the higher the age, what you must get is going to be the systolic hypertension. But after the age of 35, you have an isolated diastolic hypertension which is happening, which may be a secondary cause. Abrupt onset of hypertension. Last week I have examined the patient, had a normal blood pressure. This week he has got sudden increase in blood pressure. So far the patients had absolutely a controlled blood pressure. Suddenly his blood pressure is going out of control. This is typically happening in elderly, and when this happens, you must always suspect atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis, sudden out of control of blood pressure. Unprovoked hypokalemia or excessive hypokalemia of a diuretic, suspect primary hyperaldosteronism. So hypokalemia, primary hyperaldosteronism. Accelerated any hypertensive emergency, please. Or urgency, yesterday I told you hypertensive crisis, more than 180, 120. It can be hypertensive urgency, hypertensive emergency, accident hypertension or a malignant hypertension, always rule out secondary causes. Disproportionate hypertension mediated organ damage to the degree of hypertension. I have only 140-100. I have a severe left atrial hypertrophy. I have a grade 3 retinopathy. I have a significant albuminuria. My degree of hypertension is not correlating with a hypertension mediated organ disease. You must rule out secondary hypertension. Claudication in patients, coarctation of aorta. Unexplained anemia is a very, very important factor towards suspecting chronic kidney disease. So unexplained anemia and hypertension. Daytime sleepless or tiredness, along with 3 important symptoms. One is nocturia, more than 2 times urination in the night, the early morning headache, and nocturnal acidity. The 3 important signs of obstructive sleep apnea and daytime sleepiness. And of course, always look for the drugs the patient is taking. It may be an allopathic or other system medications. So these are some clinical pointers for a secondary hypertension to be suspected. So first we look at the briefly the basic pathophysiology of each one of the common causes we have set as cropped. So renal parenchymal disease, Dr. Atul will be talking to you something more on this in the interactive session. So I just enumerate the mechanisms by which the CKD can produce hypertension. Salt retention, we have already told you, sodium and water retention. The basic kidney injury itself can activate renin-angiotensin system, activate the sympathetic system, impair the nitric oxide synthesis, and produce significant endothelial dysfunction. And complication of CKD and the treatment itself, the complication secondary hyperparathyroidism, by increasing the intracellular calcium, it can produce significant vasoconstriction. And the erythropoietin treatment itself is one of the causes of hypertension in CKD patient. And mainly you can see the aortic stiffness, the loss of elastin in the aorta, or the calcification of the aorta will produce a significant stiff aorta, which can contribute to increase in systolic pressure. Then we come to the renovascular disease, a very important cause of hypertension, not only in the young, but also in the elderly. The common cause of renal artery stenosis is atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis in more than 95% of patients. And here, the ostium and the proximal portion of the renal artery is involved. Because we have already told you how a conduit artery gets obstructed, atheroma, block, and narrowing. So this is atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis. For a fibromuscular dysplasia, which happens in 10% of patients who are typically young or middle-aged females, they are fibromuscular dysplasia typically affects distal two-thirds of the main renal artery. The most important difference in treatment is atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis. Even after relieving the renal artery stenosis by stenting and so on, your hypertension may not come down because of infrarenal atherosclerosis of the renal arteries. So that's what we have to remember between these two renal artery stenosis. The renal artery stenosis can be bilateral or unilateral, or unilateral renal artery stenosis on a single functioning kidney. So the difference in pathophysiology is, in bilateral renal artery stenosis, you have a significant decrease in renal perfusion. Because of that, there is impaired water and sodium excretion itself. Because of that volume expansion, and there is increase in arterial pressure. And of course, decrease in renal perfusion itself can contribute to stimulation of renin-angiotensin system. So usually the volume expansion tend to inhibit the RAS system, but the main pathology seems to be decrease in GFR, ultimately the consequences of the pressure. So what is the effect of blockade of renin-angiotensin system? Only the pressure, blood pressure will come down. If at all they are, it's actually contraindicated. Bilateral renal artery stenosis, AC inhibitor is contraindicated. But if at all you want to understand the renal angiotensin mechanism in hypertension, is it can significantly lower your GFR. And of course, when you have a unilateral stenosis, what is happening is one kidney is getting reduced blood flow and another kidney is getting increased blood flow. Because of this compensatory mechanism, increase in renin angiotensin, and here the unilateral renal artery stenosis, the hypertension is predominantly angiotensin 2 dependent. So here, actually, the effect of renin angiotensin system can reduce the blood pressure, but you have to make sure that the GFR of the stenotic kidney may fall. So that is the advantage. So the difference between a bilateral renal artery stenosis and pathology, here it is a primarily volume expansion, whereas here primarily angiotensin 2 dependent stenosis. Then we come to the primary hyperaldosteronism. So the primary hyperaldosteronism, also called Kahn syndrome, should be considered in any hypertensive patient with muscle weakness because of the hypokalemia, polydipsia of hypokalemia, 70% of them due to adrenal adenoma, adrenal hyperplasia, rarely the cancer. So we know that about the aldosterone and how it is going to act on the distal or collecting duct. As you can see that here, we have specific channels which are aldosterone sensitive, and this aldosterone is acting on the mineralocorticoid receptors, is going to actually, what is going to do is significantly retain sodium here, because significantly retain sodium So it is going to block this ATPase, which is aldosterone sensitive. So it is going to block the excretion of sodium, and it is going to increase the excretion of. So sodium comes in through the endothelial, the epithelial sodium channel, and the potassium goes out through the apical channel. So this is how it ultimately goes into the lumen of the blood vessel. So this is how our increase in aldosterone is going to produce hypertension. Then we come to the very interesting disease called obstructive sleep apnea. Otherwise, I call them as obscure sinister ailment. So obstructive sleep apnea is primarily due to the narrowing of the upper airway, either because of the soft tissue abnormalities like a big tongue or big soft palate, or the abnormality in the lateral pharyngeal wall, or it may be a craniofacial abnormality which decreases the room for the soft tissue to be accumulated. Ultimately, the patient goes for apnea and hypopnea in the night. So these are the things which are happening in the night: intermittent hypoxia, sleep fragmentation, and there's a large intrathoracic pressure swing. That means you have suddenly a negative thoracic pressure, suddenly positive thoracic pressure, and it can ultimately result in oxidative stress, sympathetic nervination, hypothalamic pituitary axis stimulation, and increased preload and afterload, and then the hypertension develops, metabolic dysregulation develops, systemic inflammation, endothelial dysfunction, and ultimately it can produce significant hypertension. So any resistant hypertension patient, you must always look for obstructive sleep apnea. Through the negative thoracic pressure, it can produce a hypertensive heart disease because it is going to increase preload and afterload, and because of the chemoreceptors and pulmonary receptors, microarousal, hypoxia alternating with hypercapnia. So we have told you all these mechanisms are increased, and it can produce hypertension. And this hypertension is going to be typically, as today I told you about, non-dipper hypertension or early morning hypertension pattern, which is going to be happening through the obstructive sleep apnea. So please remember to ask the partner as far as the obstructive sleep apnea is concerned. The snoring, and the patient may not be aware of apnea, but the partner may be seeing that the patient is not breathing for some time. So these, all these things, so there's not only history from the patient, also from the history of the partner. Then of course the drugs and alcohol, there are many drugs which can produce hypertension. So it is a very important practice. Even ginseng, which is used in vitamins, can produce hypertension. And of course it is a very, very important practice and good practice. Always look through the drugs the patient is taking before you diagnose and treat hypertension. Then the hypertension and alcohol, definitely alcohol can increase and disturb the central and sympathetic nervous system. Whatever you have told you about baroreceptors, ROS system, cortisol, intracellular calcium, vascular reactivity, endothelial oxidative stress, and it can significantly increase the blood pressure. So not only alcohol increase the blood pressure, queuing for the alcohol in Tasmax, especially tonight, the Saturday night, the people are standing here and they are very stressed and they are very anxious whether they will get their material or not. So this itself also contribute to increase in blood pressure. And NSAIDs typically produces the blood pressure primarily acting through the kidney to producing a significant renal artery constriction, renal vasoconstriction. Sodium water retention can contribute to significant high blood pressure. And the uncommon causes like pheochromocytoma is going to increase the catecholamines, going to increase alpha adrenal stimulated vasoconstriction, and also the cardiac stimulation to increase arterial pressure. Cushing syndrome, because of the increase in cortisol due to ACTH secretion, is going to happen in 75 to 80% of patients, the Cushing syndrome. The mechanism is related to, once again, the cortisol is going to increase your mineralocorticoid receptors, thereby increase in the activity of aldosterone, and thereby going to increase your blood pressure. The important diagnosis we always miss in young patients is aortic coarctation. So that's why I used to say, start your examination from your masters are your patients. So you start your examination from the leg, you will be never unhappy. So it is high arm, the upper limb hypertension, lower limb, the hypotension. And once again, the mechanism is the renin angiotensin is increased because of significant decrease renal blood flow, thereby contributing to high blood pressure. So the presenting symptoms are the hypertension in the upper limb and the hypotension in the lower limb, the coarctation, the preductal or postductal region, headache, the saccular aneurysm with a high pressure can produce cerebrovascular accident, especially cerebral hemorrhage or subarachnoid hemorrhage, coronary diseases and hypertension. And the primary problem is perfusion is decreased for the kidneys to the legs and also decreased pulse pressure. So always look at the pulse to diagnose the coarctation. And lower blood pressure measurement is very important. Echocardiography, CT, MRI. Thyroid test is mandatory in all patients with hypertension. Excessive thyroid by excessive vasoconstriction, blood volume, and increase in heart rate and contractility can produce hypertension. Whereas hypothyroidism, by reducing the vasodilator metabolites, by reducing the release of vasodilators metabolites because of decrease in metabolism, can produce significant vasoconstriction and produce hypertension. So when you look at the secondary causes, the common secondary causes are going to be obstructive sleep apnea. Now it's the most common cause of secondary hypertension, followed by the parenchymal disease and renal artery stenosis and primary hyperaldosteronism, a very important emerging factor in especially in resistant hypertension. It is said 1/3 of patients with resistant hypertension ultimately have hyperaldosteronism. That is a drug of choice in resistant hypertension today, is the aldosterone inhibitor. So ultimately, we come to the summary slide here. We have so many mechanisms acting on the three important organs. One is on the heart, second is on the kidney, and the third is on the vessel. It can be a male sex, it can be a stress-increasing sympathetic system, it is either Mendelian or the multiple genetic abnormalities which can produce the various pathways of renin angiotensin system and also influence your tubular sodium reabsorption and centrally mediated sympathetic activation, increase in heart rate and contractility of increase in cardiac output. We have talked extensively about renin angiotensin system and the emergence of ACE2 these days. And of course, on kidney, we have talked enough about how the kidney is the cause and effect of hypertension. And of course, on the gastrointestinal side, we have said about the obesity and also the alcohol contributing hypertension and the endocrine, especially hypothyroidism, hyperthyroidism, pheochromocytoma, and hyperaldosteronism, ultimately contributing hypertension. And elderly age itself, due to the loss of elastin in the aorta, can cause a significant hypertension. So this summarizes the entire the spectrum of pathophysiological mechanisms of the primary hypertension. And of course, we have seen briefly the primary pathophysiological mechanisms of secondary causes. So now we have come to this slide. Why we have done so much in this slide to looking at these factors, then pathological factors, and look at this four important pathologies. If you look at the antihypertensive treatment we give, only four drugs we give. We give diuretics to reduce the preload. We give beta blockers to reduce the heart rate and contraction. We give calcium channel blocker, alpha blockers to dilate the vessels and relieve vascular spasm. We give angiotensin inhibitors to regress smooth muscle hypertrophy as well as dilate the vessels to reduce the hypertension. So your diuretics and beta blockers are going to act on cardiac output side, and your vasodilators like calcium channel alpha blocker and angiotensin inhibitors are going to act on the peripheral resistance side. So the judicious combination of these drugs acting on cardiac output, acting on peripheral resistance, will beautifully control the blood pressure and prevent future catastrophic consequences. So this is one of the statement in 2007 in one of the, I must say, from the kidney journals. The only safeguard against hypertension is to die early. So, but this statement no longer will be true if we can understand the mechanisms properly and start treating them appropriately so that we get the control of blood pressure as well as we protect the vital organs. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you, Dr. Chinnipan. I think, you made such a complicated topic very, very clearly, everybody has understood the pathophysiology of primary as well as secondary. That is why I wanted to have a master class. If you go to any webinar, when you give a topic for 20 minutes, 30 minutes, the speaker will not do justice because, he cannot explain. But, Chennaiyappan, within the short time of 1 hour, 10 minutes, he had explained the whole pathophysiology of primary as well as secondary. And I'm very, very happy that, you know, the sum and substance you completely said in the summary, and that slide, the Bronwart slide, that itself we can understand, the pathophysiology of hypertension. I think, friends, before I go to the panelists, there are a lot of popular requests that we should play that game. So today's quiz program now, I hope all of you are ready with that card. Have you opened your app? Okay, friends, the pin number for the today's game is 819-6271. Game pin 819-6271. I hope all of you have downloaded, gone into the Kahoot.it either in your laptop or in mobile. And once you are ready, enter 819-6271. Already 32 people have joined. Yes, slowly I'll wait for some more time. 819-6271. I'm glad many people have understood the process and procedure. I'll give one more minute. I think last 20 seconds, I will stop now. Last 20 seconds. I'll count down and close. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, let us start the game. Play. Ready? Yeah. In practice session 2, now the first question, systolic blood pressure is the function of A, cardiac output, B, aortic resistance, C, both, D, neither. Already I have got 47 answers, 52 answers. Still 7 seconds more. Yes. Okay. So the answer is cardiac output. I'll go to the next one. Pressure natriuresis is done by angiotensin, natriuretic peptides, catecholamines, or all of the above. Second, Good. The answer is natriuretic peptides. Next question. Baroreceptors are situated in aortic arch, carotid body, both or neither? Seven seconds more. Six, five, four, three, two, one. We have got 62 answers. Both. The answer is C, both. Systemic hypertension due to increased cardiac output is due to preload, afterload, both or neither? You see, 25 people have answered correctly, 15, 25. So you can see the media. That's how you know we are taking the tabular column and finding and finalizing the winner. So I'll go to the next question now. The scoreboard: Kalai is leading by 2894. VP is 2747. Padma is 2487. I is 2443. I'll go to the next now. The fifth question: peripheral resistance is due to preload, afterload. So afterload, the 38 people have answered correctly. Next question. Kalai is still leading. Albuminuria occurs before hypertension, after hypertension, both or neither? Three seconds, two, one. 60 people have answered both. The right answer by 32 people. Kalai is 4,365. VP is 4,002. AN is 3,916. Nathan 3,643. Rahul 3,399. Now the seventh question. The stimulus for renin secretion are hypovolemia and hyponatremia, hypervolemia and hypovolemia. Very good. 43 has answered correctly. Let us see the score. Kalai 4,958. Nathan 4,406. Navaneethan 4,184. Padma 4,015. And VP 4,002. Yes, your time starts now for the 8th question. ACE2 in COVID. Normal, down regulation, up regulation, or all of the above? Very good. Down regulation. 27 people have answered correctly. We'll see who's now standing first. Nathan is taken over. 5,231. Navaneethan next. 5,079. Kalai 4,958. Hi 4,486. Jesus. Let us see. The competition is between Nathan and Navaneethan now. Let's go to the next question. Your time starts now. Atherosclerosis is due to medial disease, adventitia disease, intimal disease. Super. Needle disease, 30 people have answered. Let's see who is now leading. Still Nathan leading, 5,866. Kalai, followed by 5,701. Hi, 5,356. The last question, we will decide the winner. The most important information in resistant hypertension is from the patient, from the partner, both. Very simple question. Last question is very simple. I think all of you will be right, I think. I know you should have finished. Very simple answer. You could have given the answer. Yes. Very good. 41 people have given the right answer. Both. The answer is both. The most important information, resistant hypertension, is from both. Now we'll go to the result. Hi, is 8 out of 6449, 9 out of 10. And the number one, 9 out of 10, Nathan. So Nathan is first, Kalai is second, and Ha is third. And the fourth place, fifth is Siman Raksi. Okay, thank you. Okay, that was the game. I hope all of you would enjoy it. Now we'll go to the panelists for the questions in the chat box. Of course, there are a lot of questions, and I'm very happy and thankful to all the panelists headed by Dr. Rajshekar. Most of the questions, yesterday were answered by Rajshekar and of course Atul in the WhatsApp group. So people who are interested can post the question in the WhatsApp group also. We have got 3 hypertension hits WhatsApp group. Pancholia, Rajshekar and Atul Pali, all of them are there in the WhatsApp group. So they will explain in detail. In fact, about orthostatic hypotension and orthostatic hypertension, Rajshekar gave a lot of information, and labile hypertension also, yesterday's question. Now we'll go to questions, and now our friend Atul is there. A nephrologist, we'll ask one by one. Pathogenesis of hypertension in hypothyroidism could perirenal artery accumulation of myxomatous material cause a renal occlusive type of hypertension. Atul, would you like to take that question?
Yes, I think Dr. Cheniappan had alluded to this aspect, and I think that is one of the hypotheses. It is hard to prove definitively that this is the case in all patients, because the best way to make that diagnosis would really be to do assessments at the glomerular level, and that is not always possible. No, you will not be subjecting each patient with a thyroid disorder to a renal biopsy. So yes, but there are many other aspects as well, like Dr. Cheniappan had mentioned in his nearing the end of his slides, including intracellular calcium concentrations and the smooth muscle contractility as well.
Okay, thank you, Atul. Dr. Abhay Singh Diora from Jodhpur. Is it advisable to record supine, standing and sitting up BP in all patients before starting them on antihypertensive therapy? How will it help in deciding the choice of antihypertensive therapy? Rajshekar, would you like to take this question? You unmute, please. You please unmute. Rajshekar, unmute. Unmute. Please unmute.
I think he has unmuted, but it's not coming. Kostop, can you check?
No, am I audible?
Yeah, now you are audible. Yes.
Probably after taking this. So definitely standing and sitting and various positions, it is better. At least even 1% of cases of to rule out secondary hypertension, it is always better. Because, for example, secondary hypertension, as Dr. Cheniappan has pointed out, this pheochromocytoma is a postural. So palpitation, that is horse racing. So definitely it has got an impact over diagnosing hypertension. So that is very important, sir.
Okay. I think the second
If I may add one more point to Dr. Rajshekar's I think Dr. Rajshekar, you mentioned an excellent point about secondary causes. As a nephrologist, because I'm seeing hypertension in chronic kidney disease patients, there is a good percentage of hypertension in these patients which is mediated by primarily by their volume sets. And that's why patients with chronic kidney disease, we must try and strive for a euvolemic state before we try to adjust the other antihypertensive medication. So checking orthostatic parameters actually helps you give the insight into their volume status. But sometimes volume depletion, much before it manifests itself as overt syncope or acute kidney injury, it will just manifest itself as orthostatic decline in blood pressure. That way you can modify your diuretic dosing.
Thank you. Chinnapan, would you like to add any other point in this question, Chinnapan?
Yes, sir. Let's say the both of Atul and Dr. Rajshekar has said good points, and it's especially when you start a hypertensive treatment, especially in the elderly. So I used to say that don't start, don't add, or don't increase any antihypertensive therapy in the elderly without checking the standing blood pressure. Not only at the beginning, it is also in every visit. So that you must, I think, remember as far as the blood pressure is concerned.
Okay. Rajshekar, today you have mentioned posted a very good article on orthostatic hypertension. There's a question now. Can you highlight about the orthostatic hypertension? I saw your article in the WhatsApp. Dr. Glenn Chen from and Asha Rani from
Ustala.
Yeah.
Orthostatic hypertension remains to be yet to be validated because it is due to neurohumoral transmission and stimulation. So orthostatic hypertension, yes, not yes. Hypertension.
Okay. You know how they measure orthostatic hypertension? I will add some more point, Rajshekar. When somebody want to check orthostatic hypertension, the person must be in the supine position for 5 minutes. 5 minutes he should be in the supine. Then he has to stand. Then you start measuring first minute, second minute, and third minute. The importance of orthostatic hypertension is because, you know, if you do ABBM, there are the extreme dippers. So because of the extreme dippers, the morning surge will be wide. So there'll be a lot of difference. Suppose the extreme dippers and the early morning surge, when the difference is more, they are the people who are going to develop cerebrovascular problem. So that is why the orthostatic hypertension is becomes important. Okay. I'll go to the Mahesh Mysore. Arterial pressure inside large organs like liver and spleen, is it same as BP measured at limb arteries? Anybody can take this question. Pancholia, would you like to take this question? Arterial pressure inside the large organs like liver, spleen, is it same as BP measured at limb arteries? If you can pass the question, we can ask somebody else.
No, sir.
Anybody? Okay, Rajshekar.
No, sir. It is not related. It is only the portal hypertension that is counted. That is not related with the, even in cirrhosis liver, even there is a portal hypertension, patient may not have a increased systemic vascular resistance. Sometimes they go hand in hand. Suppose if there is any other comorbid conditions, there is an increased level. Even in systemic hypertension, there is a difference. Even in central aortic pressure, there is a reduction of the aortic pressure itself. So everything has got its own limitations. So liver and spleen, I don't think.
Atul, would you like to add some more points on this? Atul?
Yes, I think Dr. Rajshekar hit the nail on the head. A very important point that every organ system basically has their own vascular bed, vascular anatomy. And what is fascinating to me is that Dr. Chenyappan has very elaborately mentioned the systemic renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. What is fascinating is that virtually every vital organ in the body has its own local RAS pathway. And these local RAS pathways are basically responsive to the needs of the vascular bed of that given organ. So we used to think that the kidney was controlling the whole RAS system, or at least playing the major part. But incredibly enough, that is not correct. Basically, other smaller organs, organ systems also have their own renin. Almost makes you wonder, should we even call it renin anymore? Because not just the kidney which is producing it.
Very good. Okay. Chenny, do you want to add any point, any more point in this question? Chenny Pan?
No, sir. It's already said the same thing.
Okay. Now, Dr. Satyanand from Pune, is there any way to decide whether someone is sodium sensitive or not? Atul, I think you should take the question. Can you find out somebody is sensitive or not sensitive?
Well, dietary assessments are always tricky because there's always a discrepancy between what the patient reports to you and what they actually are consuming. So the most practical way to assess this would be that we all have hypertension managed in our bodies, or like blood pressure management in our bodies, in very sodium dependent mechanisms. So I think in general, there is a very strong case to be made in any case of hypertension to have dietary salt reduction, even in patients who are not supposedly sodium sensitive per se. And not to mention, the best models of sodium sensitivity come from those monogenic hypertension models that Dr. Chenyappan was mentioning. Look at the percentages on that table that Dr. Chenyappan had put. Other than primary hyperaldosteronism, all the other sodium sensitive means of hypertension are not that common. And yet, it is incorrect if you don't counsel your patient to reduce dietary sodium intake, because it is such a central player.
Atul, why they ask this question? We normally say in a diabetic hypertension, the diabetic patients are more sensitive for salt. And also we say Indians are more sensitive for salt. So the question is there any test which you can do to find out A is sensitive or not for the salt? Is there any test like that?
Well, research studies, when they talk about salt sensitivity, they have basically conducted pre and post blood pressure assessments to populations. So basically they feed them a certain amount of sodium tablets, you know, give them a sodium load and then measure subsequently. And I believe they have a definition. If there is more than a 20 millimeter of rise in blood pressure from the pre-sodium load in the next 4 hours, then that person is considered salt sensitive. Now, okay. Practically speaking, what clinical significance does it have? Other than saying that, you know, that sodium load which you get when you go to McDonald's, you should try and avoid that.
I think Atul Bali and Rajshekar, you have homework for you. Both of you find out if there are any specific tests and come back to us in the WhatsApp group about this question. Okay.
Regarding this, so very important is there is one gene expression is called ANO4, that is an actum that is being very well expressed in zona glomerulosa rather than zona fasciculata. So that is very much related, this gene expression, that is the high salt intake, that is Western diet, that is very important. I think Dr. Chenyappan also has highlighted the genetic polymorphism, that is gene expression. This is the latest study of an actum, that is ANO4, that is very well expressed in zona glomerulosa. Again, it plays a vital role than a zona fasciculata. And also another point Dr. Chenyappan has highlighted, this alpha-adducin genetic polymorphism. Adducin is a heterodimer cytoskeleton protein. So alpha-2 and another is beta and gamma. This is alpha-adducin genetic polymorphism, again plays a vital role. That is why I want to highlight, because Chenyappan also has pointed it out. So this anactam plays a vital role.
Rajshekar, you posted one article today morning on the salt sensitivity. One article you posted. In that article, there is a column where you can find out the sensitivity. So that's why I ask you to put that homework and do tomorrow, please. Okay, Chenyappan, please, Chenyappan.
Dr. Atul, can urine sodium help?
Atul,
yes, urine sodium estimation help in salt sensitivity?
Well, maybe not in to diagnose salt sensitivity, but in a steady state, when a patient is, you know, as an outpatient, not clinically unwell, basically the sodium that we consume, we to maintain net sodium balance, we have to excrete that, that 24 urine collection. So if you want to counsel your patient about dietary sodium reduction, and you're trying to see how compliant they are, you can always do a 24 urine collection for sodium and then get an estimate of how much sodium they have consumed. But would it say that the patient is salt sensitive? Perhaps not. It would probably tell you that how much sodium they are eating each day. And I think all of us are guilty of eating more than what we need.
Any impact of this efficacy of the antihypertensive drugs in the salt sensitive patients if they consume more salt? Any impact on the efficacy?
Yes, sir. The one drug which will act in spite of increased salt is calcium channel blockers. So if you think the patient is not salt compliant, the one drug you have to give is calcium channel blockers, which will help, which will act in spite of increase in salt intake in the patient. So that is a specific drug we can give if you think the patient is not salt.
And you have to avoid the RAS blockers. Yes, you have to avoid RAS blockers because the efficacy of the RAS blockers is reduced when the salt sensitive patient consume more salt. But that is not true with resistron.
Okay, so the driver message is calcium channel blocker is the drug of choice when there is salt sensitivity. Now, Dr. Prabhu from Salem, what is the ideal mean arterial pressure, MAP, to be maintained for normal renal function in patients with shock? Atul.
It's a controversial question because the typical target that we've been setting for ages and ages is a mean arterial pressure of 65 and above. More recently, some decent data seems to suggest that in patients with renal dysfunction and patients who have baseline hypertension, they may have better renal outcomes. If you shoot for a MAP of 75 and higher. So basically, it's like if your blood pressure at baseline is much higher, then your tolerance for a lower MAP in the setting of critical illness also gets reduced. So you may have to shoot for a higher MAP target in these patients. But again, this is observational data. There is no good randomized controlled trials to say that if you randomize patients with baseline hypertension to a higher MAP, that they have better outcomes. So please take that with a pinch of salt.
Okay.
I think the ideal MAP should be around 65 millimeter of mercury.
In the critically ill patient, that is the 65 and higher is what we should be shooting for in, with the use of fluids and pressor support, etc.
Pathogenesis of hypertension and refractory hypertension in obstructive sleep apnea. Any?
I think we have said many mechanisms like pathways like sympathetic system, oxidative stress, and pituitary, hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. One main mechanism I want to highlight here is aldosterone. So it's very, very important that the aldosterone plays a crucial part in obstructive sleep apnea, not only producing hypertension, it also produces upper airway edema, which further exacerbates the obstructive sleep apnea. So that's why the specific drugs in arrestant hypertension or a refractory heart failure in a patient who's got obstructive sleep apnea is aldosterone antagonists like spironolactone or eplirenone. So many mechanisms are working. It is a huge intrathoracic swinging, the sympathetic stimulation, and also your oxidative stress, renin angiotensin stimulation, endothelial dysfunction. So many, many mechanisms are acting in obstructive sleep apnea. So it is said that not only systemic hypertension, in pulmonary hypertension, what you think as idiopathic pulmonary hypertension, 10% of them will have obstructive sleep apnea, and the pulmonary hypertension is because of obstructive sleep apnea. You will be treating them as idiopathic pulmonary hypertension with all the PDA-1 inhibitors and endothelin blockers and so on for years together. Just a CPAP or a BiPAP will cure pulmonary hypertension in that 10% of patients. So it's not only systemic hypertension, it's also valid in pulmonary hypertension.
Okay.
Dr. Chenyappan, is one of the mechanism is a sympathetic overdrive in these patients. Any role of highly selective beta blockers?
So we usually avoid any beta blockers because unless there's a compelling indication, of course. So these patients are obese, and these patients primarily will have insulin resistance as the crucial pathophysiological mechanism for hypertension. So first drug we'll prefer is angiotensin inhibitors in the form of ARBs or ACE inhibitor. The another disadvantage of any beta blocker is the weight gain. So once again, they can contribute to the weight gain and also can contribute to further increase in fat and so on. So unless there is a compelling indication, for example, you ask me, obstructive sleep apnea patient, hypertension, there is no other compelling indication like coronary heart disease or heart failure, which drug you prefer? I first prefer an angiotensin inhibitor. Then of course, a diuretic like aldosterone inhibitor. So this will act very well for insulin resistance as well as the specific drugs for obstructive sleep apnea.
Okay. Waheed Hassan from Kolkata. Role of auto-regulation of intraglomerular pressure. Does calcium channel blocker work on those conditions? Anybody?
Oh, what, sir?
Role of auto-regulation of intraglomerular pressure. Does calcium channel blocker do anything on this? Auto-regulation of intraglomerular pressure.
So, usually in a patient who has got a hypertension and especially has got some albuminuria, we try to avoid calcium channel blockers, especially the older calcium channel blockers, because they tend to produce afferent arterial dilatation and also going to increase your intraglomerular pressure. So that's what I think as far as the calcium channel blocker, as far as the intraglomerular pressure is concerned. But auto-regulation, I'm not very sure what actually the doctor means by auto-regulation and so on, how it is going to influence. But the newer calcium channel blockers, like, vinidipine, they say that theoretically they climb, that it has got less role on this afferent arterial dilatation. So if at all you want to use a calcium channel blocker when your angiotensin inhibitors are not enough to control the blood pressure in a particular patient with albuminuria, the next choice will be a sort of a newer calcium channel blockers which have got blocking all the three channels of calcium, namely the L, T and N. And the T especially plays a very crucial role in reducing the afferent arterial dilatation. Unlike our routine the calcium channel blockers like amlodipine or nifedipine. So that's what I know about calcium channel blockers and the kidney.
Okay.
I completely agree, Dr. Chaiyappan. I think the intraglomerular pressure, the most practical way of thinking about the clinical problem that elevated intraglomerular pressure causes is proteinuria. And it would truly be a mistake to consider any other drug class outside of an ACE inhibitor or an ARB as the first line of management of these patients, because there is excellent data to demonstrate that proteinuria gets reduced directly by reducing intraglomerular pressure. And perhaps the second line of drugs in these patients, because of the fact that they have chronic kidney disease, is considered a diuretic. Calcium channel blockers have not been shown to be very effective, even though there has been some theoretical benefits there. They have tried some other non-dihydropyridine type calcium channel blockers and they have not been shown effective.
Okay.
But the recently introduced ezelnidipine, in the trials that they showed not only the afferent arterial dilatation and the reduction in the proteinuria, but also there is a reduction in the markers of the renal failure also, AFA, BP and others.
Yes, not only that, this calcium channel blocker, cilnidipine, also has got both an impact over afferent and efferent arterioles. So reducing the intraglomerular pressure and improves the reduction of proteinuria also. Cilnidipine. As Dr. Chaiyappan, dual channel blocker.
Cilnidipine is dual channel, whereas benedipine is triple channel. Actually, L, T and N.
Yes, as you told, L, N, T. You have told.
L and T.
Okay.
So this is not theoretical. Actually,
a little bit of caution.
The problem.
Atul, Chaiyappan.
Yes, yes. You go ahead, sir.
Atul, you want to say something? Atul, go ahead.
No, I was just saying that we may have to interpret that data with a little bit of caution, because ultimately, what we are trying to strive for when we are reducing intraglomerular pressure and proteinuria is slowing down the progression of chronic kidney disease. And
And so far, the trials which have compared ACE inhibitors, ARBs, head-to-head with calcium channel blockers have all demonstrated that calcium channel blockers are clearly inferior.
I completely agree, but all this calcium, that's what I specifically said about this calcium channel blockers as theoretically. So because we don't have an endpoint trials, so these may reduce your surrogate markers, but are we reducing the future ESRD in these patients? So that will be the point at which we can convince ourselves that we can use calcium channel blockers for kidney protection. So that data is not available yet for even for the newer calcium channel blockers. They reduce the surrogate points like this, but surrogate point reduction is not equal to clinical point or clinical event reduction.
Atul, do you have cilnidipine in your country?
I'm sorry, sir.
Do you have the cilnidipine, the newer calcium channel blocker in your country?
No, I don't believe it has received FDA approval. I can confirm.
Yeah, very good. Okay, now the systolic blood pressure is offered by Cushion or conduit artery?
We are told it is primarily by Cushion artery, especially the aorta. It is primarily because of the stiff aorta, which transmits the pulse velocity very rapidly to the periphery, contributing to the and also the reflected wave. Because the reflected wave comes in systole itself, it sits on the already existing systolic pressure and contribute to isolated systolic pressure. It is primarily a Cushion disease.
You are really shown a dynamic slide going up and down. Very nice slide.
Not only Cushion and also skimming of small arteries also.
Manali Chandra from Kolkata. Sir, peripheral resistance causes increased diastolic blood pressure or systolic blood pressure?
We already said the peripheral resistance is a function of diastolic blood pressure. So increase in peripheral resistance is supposed to increase your diastolic pressure.
Again, Padmashri Gulati, my friend from Jhansi, what is the pathogenesis of resistant hypertension? I think that's a big question.
We have a topic on the last but one day, difficult to control hypertension. Please be patient and come to that lecture.
Padmashri Gulati, I will inform you that there's a big topic on resistant hypertension. I think you can log in that day. What would be the cause of hypertension in an adolescent with history of painless hematuria during childhood, which was due to calciuria? Atul, do you like to take this question? What would be the cause of hypertension in adolescent who had painless hematuria?
So within the constraints of the limited clinical information provided for this patient, I would have a differential diagnosis which includes something like chronic interstitial nephritis, possibly because of maybe there is nephrolithiasis which is ongoing. Hypercalciuria, you also have to consider the possibility of primary hyperparathyroidism. So I think the patient will need some endocrine and renal evaluation, because chances are that he has some underlying chronic kidney disease.
Okay. Is the stiffness in radial artery in old age due to arteriosclerosis or atherosclerosis?
It is primarily due to atherosclerosis because it's a conduit artery. So naturally, the resistance increases because of formation of intimal disease due to atheroma, or the increase in atheroma, plaque, and the plaque is rupturing, and so it's primarily atherosclerosis because it's a conduit artery.
Sandeep Kumar from Delhi, non-hypertension patient with COVID developing hypertension during treatment of active case disease, drug recommendation will be calcium channel blocker, ACE or ARB. Atul, would you like to take, because you are treating COVID patients?
Well, quite simply, this is a very specific case. My opinion about treating hypertension is that we are trying to treat either chronic sustained elevated blood pressure which causes end organ damage, or we are treating acute and severe elevation in blood pressure with evidence of end organ damage. Transient elevations in blood pressure in the acute illness setting, the best thing to do is to evaluate it again in the outpatient setting before you start any drug therapy, because chances are you might end up inducing
some problems with the patient. The commonest cause of hypertension in the inpatient setting, particularly when the patient is acutely ill, is those gigantic bags of saline that we provide to them. The typical person should be consuming between 4 to 6 grams of salt per day. Each bag of normal saline contains 9 grams. And how many of those bags do these patients get each? So I would definitely reassess outside of the acute illness before I make any treatment recommendations in these patients.
Okay. Again, we see lung involvement. ARB will be helpful, I think. Please comment. Chennaiyappan, you always say no. ARB helps in lung involvement. You have any added point, comment on that?
Well, we have put a slide to say that, for example, if your ACE2 is going to be down-regulated and the angiotensin 2 is going to be formed and it is not going to be converted into a good substance, that means you have to block this angiotensin 2 by somehow, either by an ACE inhibitor or an ARB. So that will be a logical thing to do in any patient with this thing. So I think that slide I put, it's from the New England Journal of Medicine, and that the virus entry into the cell and so on, I clearly said that the using ACE inhibitor ARB reduces the lung injury.
Yeah, correct. Now I have so many questions. I think I'll stop with two more questions. Is there any entity called hypotension? Is there any treatment for it?
Hypotension, is there? Definitely there is an entity called hypotension. We cannot say hypotension. But what you have to differentiate is between hypotension and shock. Hypotension, just the number of below a particular number like 170 or 90-70. With patient absolutely all right with no vital organ compromise, is just hypotension. But a patient with 170 with cold peripheries and decreased urine output and a little bit of confusion, I'll be more worried about this 170 rather than this 90-70. So the hypotension is not equal to shock. So whenever there is a shock, it means you have low blood pressure plus vital organ perfusion abnormality. There you have to actually look at what is causing the shock and treating it. In an absolutely asymptomatic patient who has got a hypotension, I think we have to see that he has to increase his salt intake and he must gradually get up from the lying to standing position and so on. And upscore, we can always reassure him to say that he's blessed. So many patients are taking 6 drugs and their pressure is still 160-100. And you are not taking any drug and your pressure is 170. And you are completely asymptomatic and without symptoms. And there is no other cause of hypotension. You have to rule out a valvular heart disease. You have to rule out a Addison's disease. You have to rule out a hypothyroidism. So you are excluding everything and still patient is absolutely all right with a little bit of low pressure, he is blessed.
No, the problem for the patients, when they stand for 20 minutes together in the sunlight or in a daylight, they tend to fall. That is the main symptom when they have the low BP.
That means he is a symptomatic hypotension. What I meant is that he is hypotension without any symptom. That means you have to go through the battery of tests to identify why he has got low pressure. So we have so many causes of hypotension. So we have to address to that.
The last question is, does viscosity of blood column have a major role in pathogenesis? Do hematological agents lower blood pressure? Any one of you? Does viscosity of blood column have a major role in pathogenesis of hypertension?
So we don't see like this, but example, you see these case of polycythemia vera. So how many percentage of those patients have got hypertension? The viscosity of the blood are primarily going to increase your tendency for thrombosis actually. So it is one of the triads for creating a thrombus. So in that way, it can occlude a vessel and can produce a vital organ under perfusion and so on. But per se, viscosity per se, I don't think they contribute to hypertension.
Okay. I think there are so many questions pending. As I request all the panelists tomorrow, please be kind enough. If there are any questions, you can answer in the WhatsApp group. So final one word from each one of the panelists and then we'll conclude. Atul, you start with your drive-home message for today.
I think the most important aspect as a clinician is to be alert for possible causes of secondary hypertension, because if you don't look, you will not find them.
Good, very nice. Rajshekhar.
Sir, we should not diagnose always if this is a case of primary hypertension. Even if there is 1% of chances of secondary hypertension, we must look into the cause and diagnose. That is very, very important. That is today's message from Dr. Chenniappan's talk.
Yeah, and also, even primary hypertension patients, 20-30% patients can have secondary hypertension also, along with the primary hypertension. That is also, true, I mean, given in the literature. Good, good point, Rajshekhar. Pancholia?
To understand the understanding the pathophysiology of hypertension is very important to know about the complications of hypertension and also to decide about the therapy for the hypertension, for the proper control and proper management of hypertension.
Okay, nice. Chenniappan, final word from you, then we can.
Final word from me is good night, sir.
Okay. I think, you know, we had an exhaustive talk on various subjects, I mean, various aspects of pathophysiology of hypertension. And I think we'll repeat this also. Once we have the record, we'll give it to, keep it in the website. So people who have got some doubts, we can definitely go through. There are a lot of questions on COVID and the ARB and the hypertension. So we can take one topic on COVID in the advanced course, Chenniappan. Because there are more questions on COVID and hypertension and mechanism and things like that. So I think we'll
in a couple of webinars, I delivered lecture on this managing hypertension in COVID, okay. Focusing on RAS blockers.
Yeah. There were a lot of questions, so I thought we'll have one more lecture, you know, in our new course. I think it was a very good talk on pathophysiology. I think most of you would have understood. So maybe if you have any doubt, please feel free to ask us in the WhatsApp. We'll explain. And Rajshekhar is there to, you know, put their, you know, needed article. Atul Bali also is very good. Today morning I saw he was answering few questions. So Pancholia, you must also start answering questions. That's why I keep all the three in three different groups, so that you'll answer the questions.
I joined the group today only.
Yeah, we'll ask you questions and, you know, it's easy. Yes. Somebody asks a question in WhatsApp, you can leisurely, you know, even refer and then answer, right answer correctly. So that'll be good also. So with this, I think this is Dr. Muruganathan signing off from all of you. Good night, and we'll meet you on 4th September with another interesting topic on a master webinar. And 4th and 5th, we'll have Friday and Saturday, two more webinars like that. And thank you, Pancholia, for your participation as a faculty member. Dr. Atul Bali, thank you. And maybe we will invite you for subsequent webinars also, both of you. And from the ACP India chapter, we really thank both of you for your participation. Rajshekhar, we'll see you tomorrow in the WhatsApp group. So thank you, Chenniappan. Thank you very much. Take care. Chenniappan had an LRI, you know, in the morning. I was a little worried.
Thank you.
Luckily, he's now better. So take care, Chenniappan. Thank you very much. And looking forward to your next lecture on Friday, that is 4th September. Good night.
Thank you, sir.
Good night. Thanks to IPCA for, you know, your support. And we'll send you the link and other details on Monday about the next program, next panelist, etc. Thank you very much. Thank you. Good night.
Good night. Good night, sir. Good night, all of you. Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.